How is the crisis that hit Ireland affecting Dublin as a city?
Well, I mean, when you go along the streets, there are vacant commercial lots. And that's a result of consumer spending. And consumer spending doesn't have the confidence to go out there and spend. I mean, we had a good economy. We had a good economy probably till 2002. And I think thereafter, we lost the plot. We lost our... and we don't need investigations. You know, a four-year-old child could draw a picture and tell you what happened. Within the European Union, or the Euro, it was low interest rates. Within Ireland, we had, the country was doing well, and when we needed to have high interest rates, we had low interest rates. And now the reverse is happening. When we need low interest rates, we have high interest rates. And that's obviously a factor of being a member of the European Union, or the Euro, should I say. And within the Euro, it's the dominant countries that will dictate where we are. I mean, I'm sure it happens in America, where you've individual states suffering and then you've bigger states either doing well or doing badly, and the interest rate and the spending reflecting the bigger states or the bigger countries in Europe, what they need. But there was also no control in regarding construction, no control really to speak of regarding banking, regarding lending policies. And the thing became a pyramid scheme based on property, or a Ponzi scheme. Mm. And in a pyramid scheme, you know, it's not in anyone's interest to say this is crazy. And really what happens then is it's the last fool who's holding the property, who's got the big loan. And unfortunately for Ireland, it was of such scale that we will be paying for this for many years.
But did this reflect the revenues for the city as a city budget?
Because local government in Ireland isn't very decentralised, we're very dependent on central government funding.
To what extent?
Commercial rates, off the top of my head I'm not sure, but it's well over 50%.
Right.
So I mean, there was this sense that money was flowing around within central government and it was coming down to the local authorities and everyone was happy and people thought they were wealthy out there because, well, I live in a house that, you know, we could sell for $1 million and it only costs us 250,000. And the reverse has happened. That said, there's been significant infrastructure projects that have been delivered to the country, particularly to do with roads over the last number of years. But I would argue that the cost with 400 and nearly 50,000 people unemployed isn't acceptable.
Right, in the city?
450,000 people nationally,
okay.
Nearly 14%.
Well, that's a lot.
It's a huge lot, especially coming from a situation where we were around 3 or 4%, which in economic terms is just frictional, you know, where people move or in between jobs.
Okay.
It's regarded as you cannot get more than 96-97% employment because people are moving jobs. So to a large degree, what was happening in Ireland is we had Eastern European people being attracted into the country to build houses, particularly males, to build houses that were being rented to them to live in the country, to build the houses. And, you know, it was just a mad situation. People lost their own themselves. Fortunately, I have my own business for the last 9 years, and in the good times I put plenty, it's a small business, but I put plenty of money in reserves, so I have not had a bank overdraft or a bank loan with the business in probably about 4 or 5 years.
Okay, you said that there is no big decentralization. Is there a process of decentralizing? Because this is a big issue in Bulgaria too, and this year we have local elections.
Yeah. In Ireland, you know, you look at these, and perhaps he was Lord Mayor. No, he wasn't, but maybe that man was Lord Mayor. You know, when this office, 150 years ago, was a very powerful office, and what's happened to the office is one very centralised government. Then you overlay that with EU competition rules, EU procurement, health and safety legislation. And what's happened in Ireland is local government itself has become quite weak, but also position of mayor or Lord Mayor is now largely ceremonial as opposed to executive. I've probably been quite executive rather than ceremonial in my approach to it, trying to deliver on specific projects. There is a proposal in 2014 in the programme for government that there would be directly elected Lord Mayor of Dublin. That directly elected mayor, it should be called. That directly elected mayor would have significant authority in terms of spending, budgets, etc. There is also a proposal that there will be a property tax.
Yeah.
And also a water tax, a water charge.
Yeah.
And I think that's what we have to do in Ireland. We have to rebalance. I would argue that we have probably management within local government that is trying to acquire power but doesn't have the authority because it has not been elected. You have weak public people like myself, not weak, but my position isn't strong.
Yeah.
And so you get this type of, you know, whereas you need a directly elected mayor or a leader of council that says, this is what is to happen, boom, 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 you are to do this. And that's the way you deliver action, because in being elected, you have been given responsibility.
Yeah, of course, and people have certain expectations then.
Yes.
Which need to be fulfilled.
Need to be fulfilled. And, you know, I mean, I would argue that's the process that should be.
Yeah.
But the trouble is, and I'm sure it's in Bulgaria than nowhere else, sometimes, you know, we employ people to do the task that the board of directors, be it the city councillors, do, but then the employees, they try to become the bosses. I mean, and I think it can be difficult, particularly to do with weakened local government in councillors not having significant powers. They don't know how to exercise the power. I come from a business background. You make a decision and you hand it over to someone, and then if they fail to deliver on that decision by bad performance or not executing it, you get rid of them, you fire them or whatnot. Unfortunately, you have this type of councillors in Ireland. They don't want to make decisions, or if the decision proves to be unpopular, they want to reverse it, or they want to have long drawing out processes, whereas really you need, I would argue we have 52 councillors in Dublin. It's way too many councillors for effective decision making. Apparently in America, say, a town the size of, I think it's Portland in Oregon, similar size.
And the councillor actually represents a certain area of the city, or?
It does, yeah, but there's, I think 12 or 13, there's been some change, 12 or 13 different areas, but when in each area there's multi-seat constituencies. So you could have 5 councillors or 6 councillors or 4 councillors representing one area.
You've mentioned the Eastern Europeans as a workflow towards Ireland, but is there the internal process from smaller towns and villages to the bigger cities, and Dublin specific?
Probably more to Dublin rather than, yes, there has been not a de-rurification, but farms have become more bigger. There is one issue in Ireland, I would say, that's the issue of one-off housing, where people who have land have been selling land for people to build one house on its own. The European Union is taking Ireland to court to do with septic tanks, where the effluent is supposedly dealt with. We have a situation in County Galway, which is in the west of the country. I mean, there's so many once-off housing that there have been particular problems to do with the drinking water quality. And in Galway City, there was a situation maybe for 2 months where people had to buy water or boil water. So, I mean, these things, I mean, the EU isn't there to penalise countries for, you know, it's a bit like you go to school and you think the teachers are trying to be mean to you. You know, they have to maintain discipline, but they're also trying to teach you subjects. The EU isn't doing a lot of these things for bad reasons. They're doing it for right reasons, be it to do with the use of fertilisers on land and being washed off into the river, animal access to river courses that foul up the river courses, one-off housings, septic tanks, erosion of bog in Ireland, peat bog.
Yeah.
So a lot of these things, you know, are there for good reasons, or the EU is trying to do them for good reasons. Use of competition law to affect, to break down monopolistic tendencies, and also to make sure that, you know, government and local authorities cannot exercise, you know, monopolistic markets where the prices are kept artificially high, etc., etc.
Right. How is the cleaning of the city organized? This is a very painful issue in Bulgaria. And like I spoke to some people here in Dublin, they would say, well, it's not very clean. And I was so surprised because it seems very clean to me.
It is clean. It is clean. The city council has, you know, both hand carts and also a lot of mechanical sweepers, both for pavements and for...
The ownership is of the city council, private firm that is hired to do the job.
No, city council. And then within a certain area called Temple Bar, they have additional cleaning. And then there is this thing called BIDS, which stands for Business Improvement Districts. And that was voted in 3-4 years ago. And what happens is, on top of the commercial rates that businesses pay within the agreed area where they've taken a referendum and said, yes, we want to go with a business improvement district, it's in New York, it's in many American cities, those businesses are levied an additional 3%. That's the rate fixed for Dublin. I don't know what it is in America or other places. So the city council charges an extra 3% in the commercial rates, and that 3% goes to a standalone company which is known as the BIDS company, Business Improvement Districts, and they do additional cleaning, anti-graffiti.
Right.
No, Dublin is a clean city now, and I mean, I've spoken to people from other countries and they've said...
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
The other thing is, I don't know, one significant thing I would say, well, dog fouling isn't allowed. You know,
I saw very nice signs.
Yeah, I mean, I would go running in a park near me most mornings, and in fairness to dog owners, they will take a plastic bag and remove the dog foul. Also, one big improvement in Dublin has been, I don't know how it is in Bulgaria, but when I was a child, people would have metal bins, or they would just have plastic bags.
Yeah.
And then you would have dogs or birds or foxes, they'd come around and tip them over.
Spread the litter.
Or when the bins were being collected, some rubbish would spill out and it'd be left there. Whereas now we have wheelie bins, which are... So I don't know, how is that in Bulgaria?
Well, it's a very painful issue, and especially this one with the dogs. And who is taking care of finding dog owners? Or?
Well, I think it's social pressure. You know, it's very hard.
Social pressure,
yeah.
This is something we lack, unfortunately.
Yeah, I mean, I see people and I know Well, it will happen. It will happen. I mean, also, what was significant in Ireland is a minister from another party, so I can speak properly, he introduced a plastic bag levy. Now, I don't know what the situation is in Bulgaria.
We're trying.
A small nominal amount, I think it was 5 cent or 10 cent, and it removed probably 85% of plastic bags like that. And what was happening is they were just being discarded because people were getting them free. They were ending up on fences and bushes.
And trees.
And like trees, yeah.
And to what extent the citizens are responsible to clean around their area?
No.
They're not?
They're not.
Okay, and I didn't see stray dogs in Dublin.
No, you need to have your dog on a leash. And there's only certain areas where dogs are permitted. In the park where I go running every morning, dogs are permitted off a leash until 11 o'clock.
But there are no dogs that have no owners. Is this what you get?
No, we don't. I'm sure they're rounded up and taken to a dog's home. And if no one claims them, then they're put down.
Okay, is there a deadline for this?
I'm not sure. It depends. And then you have animal charities who seek to get these dogs rehoused. But when I was young, there was dogs walking around the place, stray dogs.
Yeah, we have an enormous problem in Sofia specifically. And there is a lot of argument what to be done with these dogs. And it's really a stalemate, actually, between the people who would defend the dogs to be actually killed if there's no one to adopt them. But, you know, the opposite group would say, no, they're animals, we shouldn't do this, and the problem is never solved.
In Ireland, you need to have a dog license.
Right.
I don't know what the situation is in Bulgaria.
The same, but
most people don't.
Yeah, and obviously no one is taking care of checking upon dog owners.
I think, you know, I mean, I wouldn't be, these things come around in time, and it will happen, but I do think at the end of the day, people have to bear in mind they have their own responsibility of not littering and not allowing their dogs to foul the streets. Particularly dog foul is it's a health hazard as well.
Absolutely.
You get a child and it can cause blindness or something. Slowly.
Absolutely. And we've also mentioned somewhere earlier in the conversation about public procurement. Is there a well-working system in the city, public procurement?
I wouldn't think so. I mean, we're a very big organisation. We've 6,000 employees. I don't know how many mobile phones. I think, unfortunately, what happens, particularly with big companies, like big organisations, they have to comply with public procurement policy, that has to comply with EU policy. It can really strangle an organisation. As a city council, we have set up a limited company to manage our newest sports centre. Very expensive sports centre, but we have maybe 20 other sports centres. This is the new one. And the reason we did that in terms of the ability to make quick decisions, have a focus on what the product is, and also the fact that we were paying employees in the other leisure centres 30% in excess of the industry rates. So we set up a limited company. I'm a director, so are two other councillors, independent chairperson, three employees of the city council in the sports area are also directors. But what it's allowed us to do, one, pay industry standards, two, bypass procurement policy, and three, have a keen focus on what the job in hand is for the company, and that's to deliver sports services. It's not to be, you know, making sure, oh, we comply with this policy and health and safety. And I think also big organisations can say, oh yes, we do this and we do that. When you drill down in terms of procurement, you can bypass a lot of procurement. Do you know what I mean? Contracts under 2,000 over 10,000 have to be procurement. So what they do is they break down an individual contract into four or five, and they just they give the order verbally, and then they get the invoice, and then they fill in the purchase order from the invoice. So I wouldn't have. It's very hard to dictate. You know, big organisations are problematic, and I would be of the view to really get effective. And I was talking to someone from our transport company last Monday. He's Dublin Bus, so they probably are paying. You know, for long distance bus journeys, they contract out the work. But I would think for Dublin, they probably pay in excess of rates. And in time, what we should have is, we should have a public oversight, but private delivery.
Right.
You understand what I mean?
Yeah.
It's very hard. I mean, the most expensive thing in any organisation, certainly in Ireland, I don't know about Bulgaria, is labour.
Well, in Bulgaria, the thing is that many people, when you say private, they think of corruption. So it's a sensitive issue too.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I've my own business. I've been in the commercial area for 30 years. There's corruption in public, but it's not evident because it's incompetent, it's lazy, it's overpaid. You know, there's so many agendas. People give jobs to brothers or sisters or fathers or uncles or aunties, or, and you get a poor recruitment policy. You don't get recruitment of smart people or people who are work hard. You get poor performance. I'm not saying this is generalization.
Absolutely, yeah, I understand.
So I mean, you know, you can point to the private sector and say corruption. Yeah, maybe there is, but you know, there is, I would say, corruption in public bodies through, you know, lazy, way too many holidays, no sacking.
Yeah.
You know, we're twinned with San Jose. They have 97% union membership. I don't know what it is in the city council, it's probably even higher than that. In the private sector, in that area in San Jose, union membership is 6%. It's very hard to sack people in the public sector. So it mightn't be corruption, but it's the same effect. You get so many agendas between people saying, oh, the secure job, I can sit back. What you need in the private sector and in the public sector is you need good corporate governance. And corporate governance is about board membership, it's about, and I mean, I don't know why people don't cop on to this, you know, understand this. Boards should be maximum of 12 people, ideally 8 people, maybe 10 people, no more, certainly. And what board membership should have? It should be paid, not huge amounts, and you know, you can vary it. You should have a mix of personality type, a mix of experience, and a mix of training. So, you know, you might have an aggressive accountant who is quite young. You might have a very, you know, an elderly executive who has been chair of a number of companies, who is much more reflective. So you get the mix. And I'm amazed. I mean, I would use more of my own techniques as Lord Mayor in my own business. I can't understand why people just don't apply them throughout. I'm on the board as Lord Mayor of University College Dublin. I don't know how many thousands of students. There's about 50 or 60 on the governing body. It's impossible to make decisions. And what happens is decisions are made outside the governing body meeting. They're made outside the board of directors.
So like lobbying or something?
Well, they're made and then it comes to the meeting and people go, yeah, you know, a group of people are organised to say yeah. And so the meeting means nothing. But if you have proper, effective governance, corporate governance, we had a situation in Dublin where we set up a Dublin Docklands development. It was a smashing company. It was set up because there was an area of Docklands that was run down and wasn't being used by the port, etc., etc., and it needed redevelopment. And the company was terrific. Really good developments as you go down the river. What happened was there was board members from Anglo-Irish, which went bust. There was chair of Anglo-Irish sat on the Dublin Docklands, another director for Anglo-Irish. There was cross directorships. There was loans from Anglo-Irish Bank being given to companies involved in Docklands. And then all you have to do is generate those conditions, poor conditions, and you get bad decisions. And the Dublin Docklands, which had a terrific record of development, became an investor in a site, along with private investors, that it had planning authority over. I mean, bonkers stuff. Do you understand? And the site was bought for over 400 million. It's now valued at less than 100 million.
Right.
So that was a result of poor corporate governance at board level. Do you understand?
Yeah.
And allied to that, that's one level, that's the top level. Then what you need is you need effective weekly, daily, monthly, whatever needs, management accounts, if that's the way. And you need to have continual performance measurements. It's a simple equation. I mean, in my company with 6 employees, I have monthly management accounts every month. Every Friday, I have sales figures.
Right.
Every week of the year. In Dublin City Council, we have a corporate plan for 5 years, and the only figures in it are the page numbers.
Right.
Now, I voted against that corporate plan. That's for 5 years. And then they produce...
That's for 5 years. How does it to be to develop? Or
yeah, and it's all...
And blah, no blah, figures. Blah, 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 blah,
blah, blah. You know, we shall do this, and we might do this, okay. And we'd love to do that. And then we had a review last Monday week, I think it was at the City Council meeting, and there was another 10 pages of blah, 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 blah. You know, what you need is you need performance management measurement all the time, allied that to corporate governance. Simple rules, they're not complicated. The only reasons people may think complicated is to hide stuff. Hide corruption, hide incompetence, hide bad performance, that's all.
Yes, but nonetheless, all people I spoke to while I was here say that in the past 20 or 30 years, the city and the country in general, but the city particularly, has developed enormously, and
absolutely.
It can be seen. Whose fault is this? I mean, whose
that it's developed?
Is this? Yes. Is this these plans with no numbers, aside from the page numbers, or is it what the society requires, or a joint effort?
No, I think EU membership had a huge impact on Ireland and the funds.
You think so?
Absolutely. We were probably lucky. We were in early. I think also Ireland, you know, we're a small country. We can be innovative and say, unlike other countries like France, which are very allied to tradition, bureaucracy, we're not that allied. We're small enough to be flexible.
Yeah.
We have a decent enough industrial policy. What we don't have is, and I think it'll happen over the next year because there's a sense that we have to change, is we need a reform of government and a reform of local government. I think we need to, see, in some commercial, very successful commercial companies, they break out what is their core business activity and what's not core. And unfortunately, say in Dublin City Council, we're involved in bin collection. Now we pay more money and they probably work less hours than private bin collectors, and they're eating into our market. So what we should do is we should be concerned with planning policy, we should be concerned with waste policy. You know, Dublin Bus are the Irish Transport Group shouldn't be involved in employing drivers. It should be setting out routes and putting them out to tender and checking up the performance of those private operators.
So you think that most of the services could be outsourced to
absolutely.
Private companies, and the City Council and the Lord Mayor to focus only on planning and how to develop the city, is that correct?
Planning, yes. Housing, you know.
Yeah, housing.
That we have fire service. Obviously, there's certain services nationally and locally that, if given to private operators, they would become very profitable monopolies.
That's true too. Yeah.
So, from a national point of view, it's essential that our gas grid is maintained in government, our national control. Our electricity...
And now it is maintained by locals?
No, government.
Okay.
It's a government-owned company. Our electricity supply distribution network should always be kept in government or national control. We did sell off our telephone, our national telephone,
yeah,
and that has been to the detriment of the country, in that there's been a series of pirates who have plundered the company,
mm-hmm,
and hopefully now it's in stable ownership again, and it may, but apart from that, you know, the one issue, I'm not trying to simplify everything, but the one issue is probably the health service and also education. Very difficult areas to quantify and measure, particularly health service. You know, you go in with a hip and then you develop a complication, and then you develop another complication, and you can't say this hip cost 4,000 and this one only costs 1,000. How do you measure, and can that be privatized? Maybe not.
Well, these are very serious issues that are being debated in all member states, and I think that it depends very much on each country, because each country has a tradition, its own evolution and path that it's going on. So it all seems very interesting. You're so very much private oriented, which I really myself support, but I'm not sure that in my country that could be ever supported. But just to summarize, what do you think are the short and long-term challenges for the city?
For the city? You know, when I came to the office, I had a theme, was we have to accentuate the positive and eliminate the negative. As chair of the policing committee, which I was chair for the last year before I became Lord Mayor, some of the issues within the city centre and city generally was there was a huge level of begging on the streets. And this had a lot to do with there was many Romans coming into the city and begging. That came about because in 2007 there was a very old piece of legislation called the Vagrancy Act, dating from the 19th century, which was found to be unconstitutional. Then from 2007 through to the February 2011, there was no effective legislation to allow the police, say, to people who are persistently or aggressively begging, to move on. One of the last acts of government which I campaigned for was that they passed effective legislation. And the numbers of beggars on the streets has gone, I would say, declined by about 90%.
It's very interesting. What does this legislation say? What does the police do with the beggars?
They ask them to move on. And if they fail, you know, the police have to use their head.
Okay.
But if they fail, they can bring them to court and they can be subject to jail.
Right. Yeah, I really didn't notice a lot of beggars
no.
in Dublin.
Well, if you came last January, February, I mean, there was a picture where you had the three people from the IMF walking past, and then a beggar sitting against a metal cabinet on the street, and one of the newspapers put the face of the Prime Minister on the beggar as the three IMF people were going by, you know, Photoshop it for the front of the paper. That was a particular problem. And myself and the assistant police commissioner, we set up a safety forum for the city centre.
What is this safety forum?
It's, we meet every month with representatives of the Chamber of Commerce, Dublin City Business Association, Temple Bar Traders, which is just a recreation area, businesses there, the Business Improvement Districts Company, Dublin City Council, and the police, myself chairs. So the one another big issue that came up from that was the number of people in the city centre on drug maintenance programs. So you get people congregating in trees and forests talking, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And my background is marketing, but if you lose, the mother tends to be the gatekeeper in terms of buying decisions for clothes, for X, Y, and Z. Groceries are a week-to-week thing in locally. But the city centre would be much more reliant on clothes and perfume and luxury goods. I have three daughters. If younger women feel intimidated, then they don't come into town, into the city. They go to shopping centres out of town. So they get out of the habit. So as they grow older, and as their mothers, they won't come into the city centre. So you would get a rundown of the city centre. And we have problems in the city centre. You walk down the streets and you see vacant. I mean, 3 years ago, there was no vacant sign, to let sign up on buildings.
Yeah.
Now there is many. There's a lot. So the incidents and the management of people on drug maintenance is a particular problem. And also, there was a requirement for homeless people to come into the city centre to be registered on a daily basis. Or they were in hostels and they were told, okay, 8 o'clock in the morning, out you go after your breakfast, don't come back till 6, 7 o'clock at night. So they'd all day to do nothing. So I think you have to be very careful about the public domain, that street space, because I do think it is precious. You know, shopping centres, there's security guards with walkie-talkies and they don't let people having a political issue in, or they don't do this, it's security guards. I think the public domain is a very important place.
Yeah.
And I do think, you know, we create cities, we charge big commercial rates, and it's important and it's imperative on the city council, from a selfish point of view, for its commercial rates, to make sure that that city centre area is maintained and protected, and that people don't go elsewhere to out-of-town shopping centres. The other thing is, and so that's eliminating the negative, you know, begging, incidents of people on drug maintenance, so,
yeah.
Oh, and people feel intimidated by this. Accentuating the positive is trying to promote the city centre from a marketing point of view, get a bit of activity going, and also in villages around the city. I think it's also important to maintain those villages because, okay, well, I'm not that young, but as people get older, they rely on local villages to do shopping, to socialise, and they're important points of social contact for them. If shops in those villages, if you get two or three vacancies, then the whole thing type of collapses downwards.
Yeah.
So what we've done in the Mansion House here, in, for starters, last August, I walked 30 villages and met with traders and my chains and whatnot. And then at the end of August, we had the workshop, Your Village, Our City, and trying to get business groups within the villages to work together, both as a network for themselves, so that you have a business, you know someone who needs flowers and I sell flowers and you tell me and bam 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 bam, and also in terms of promoting the village and creating social events in the village. So there's, from my efforts, there's been about 5-6 startups where people have come together to promote their village. And I do think, you see, one way people have this, oh yeah, what are the government going to do to me, for me, you know, who's going to do that, can we get any grants, blah blah blah. Once you liberate yourself from that thinking, you say, well, if it is to be, it's up to me, if it is to be, it's up to me, if it's going to be done, we have to do it for ourselves. Do you understand?
Absolutely. And I'm trying to figure out who is to make this mindset in people?
Well, I mean, in Bulgaria, did you have a communist system where
yes.
people were poorly yes. provided for, but they were provided for?
Yes, and still 20 and plus years later, people still rely on someone else to take care of them. And this, I think, is tragic, because if you're not self-reliant, you do not evolve, you do not create, you do not progress.
But I mean, you know, that's a short time. When I was campaigning for the general election in February, I had someone who works in Aer Lingus, which is the national airline, but Aer Lingus has been privatized 3 years or 4 years at this stage. She was trying to talk to me about a dispute they were having with the management in Aer Lingus. So, I mean, that's only 3 or 4 years ago. So, I mean, 20 years, sometimes you need one full generation and more to get a mindset. I mean, it's very hard to change the culture of an organization. And if you had a dominant culture in Bulgaria, where it was state provision, very hard to change that.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah.
You just keep having to throw yourself against the wall to effect change, or keep knocking down the wall. But I do think, and you see, I would be quite tough at one end, that, you know, if people are involved in fraud or this, that, and the other,
yeah.
they should go to jail, commercially or whatever. But at the other end, I would be very pro-business, but at the other end, there should be correct provision for people who cannot provide for themselves. And a lot of people, you know, they have mental illness, they cannot hold down jobs.
Yeah.
As we say in Ireland, they suffer from their nerves, which means, you know, they're nervous, or they get anxious about the smallest of tasks. But you see, and I spoke at Dublin City Business Association annual general meeting inside here at the Open, and I said we need to promote and not promote we need to sing about business, because the profit motive, our survival motive, is it's a very simple agenda. And as I was saying to you, is sometimes in non-profit organizations you get so many agendas.
Yeah.
At least to a degree in profit-oriented or survival-oriented organizations or companies, you get a meritocracy. If people perform, they will be promoted.
Right.
Whereas in you know, where there's no requirement to perform, it's, you know, an uncle of a brother or a brother of an uncle. And so, you know, I think there's a purity about the profit motive that people don't, you know, some left-wing people tried to give it a bad name. I would say, I wouldn't apologize. I think we should sing about it.
Okay, I think that this is a very good finale for our interview. And
okay.
I'd like to thank you very much for your time.